The Third Republic of France lasted until World War II, and this government was plagued with many scandals, the most notable of which was the Dreyfus Affair. Now, Alfred Dreyfus was a captain in the French army. He was Jewish, which meant he was looked upon with some skepticism because he didn't fit that perfect national picture of what it was to be French. Remember, in the age of nationalism, we all shared a culture and shared, you know, a heritage. And we also all ate the same things and had the same religion. And so Jews, they might have been French as well, but they were also something else. They didn't really fit into the picture perfectly. So despite the fact that he was Jewish and kind of was looked at with some cynicism, he was able to reach the level of captain because his record was impeccable. And yet, despite this impeccable record, he is put on trial in October of 1894, accused of the worst kind of treason there is, if you are French, which is spying for Germany, which is their number one enemy. The trial was done in a military court, and so the records were kept secret. It is important to note that there absolutely was a spy. Dreyfus made a convenient scapegoat. Somebody had to take the blame. And he's convicted, sent to Devil's Island in South America. Now, this would have, under other circumstances, perhaps been the end of it. But at the same time, another man who seemed the more guilty, he had a criminal record already, or maybe not a criminal record, but he had done some, had gotten in trouble before, okay? And he was from a notorious noble family, and he seemed to be guilty, but, you know, here you have this man with the impeccable record getting convicted and this sort of shady character being convicted, I mean, being, sorry, exonerated. And, you know, it rubs some people the wrong way, basically. Again, because it's a military trial, all of the records were kept secret. So nobody really knew the evidence that was used to convict Dreyfus. They just knew that, you know, it didn't really make sense to them. Now, again, this could have been the end of it because the records are secret, but we had this celebrity, this writer named Emile Zola, who began to investigate. And because he was a celebrity, people talked to him, and he found out that a lot of the evidence used against Dreyfus was forged and that people had lied under oath. And so he ended up publishing this evidence in the newspaper, and the public ended up forcing the army to release the secret documents that did prove that Dreyfus was in fact innocent. However, it's not for years later that he ends up having another trial and getting released. Now, it is important to note that Emile Zola was a celebrity. You know, lots and lots and lots of books, and back in the end of the 1800s, you know, being a writer was a very prestigious. You know, we had the beginnings of movies. Movies weren't big, and writers were really very well respected and very popular and a main form of entertainment. Again, he uses his prestige to get all this information, which he publishes in the newspaper. This sort of open letter, J'accuse, a letter to the President of the Republic by Emile Zola. And he ends up going on trial for libel. That becomes the trial of the century. Again, he's a celebrity on trial for libel, which he is convicted. He flees to Europe. It's all very dramatic. The bottom line after the entire affair is over is that there is rampant anti-Semitism, hatred of Jews. And the Jews begin to call for their own country. Again, this is the era of nationalism. If we have an identifiable heritage and culture, we should have our own country. But there's no place for them in Europe, so they start to move to Palestine. This movement for having an independent Jewish country in Palestine is called Zionism. The Jews move to basically the desert. They are sold absolutely barren wasteland. But what people in Palestine don't realize is that the Jews are bringing with them all of the knowledge of the Industrial Revolution. And so they are able to turn, in a matter of a mere decades, what had been wasteland, desert, into vibrant cities, you know, factories, jobs, modernization, and they start to really bump heads against the existing cultures that are there, namely the Palestinian Muslims. And this sets the stage for a future century of conflict.